Good evening, everyone, and welcome to episode 49 of this season of Guru Manthan. Thank you for joining us this 49th episode. It's been happening every Saturday, 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. The Guru Manthan talks are being organized by the Vivekananda Institute for Leadership Development, which is an initiative of SVYM. And WeLead is embedded within SVYM and aims to build human and social capital for nation building and engages across four sectors: the government, NGOs, MSMEs, and the community, with a special focus on the youth. Guru Manthan is an initiative, a platform where teachers have come, shared, discussed, debated, and learnt about diverse perspectives and practices in education from across the world. As always, the format of the talk would be that the guest speaker would speak for about 25 minutes, followed by a moderated Q&A. You could leave your questions in the chat box, and then that will be followed by a closing concluding remarks. Today, it's a pleasure to have Ms. Maya Menon, founder director, the Teacher Foundation. Maya has been in the field of education for over three decades. Her areas of professional experience include conceptualizing, designing, and implementing a wide range of school and teacher-related projects. Her interests span school effectiveness, research, including school improvement, teacher development, collaborative approaches to teaching, interpersonal communication in the classroom, leadership, and strategic management of schools. She has been a full-time teacher trainer since 1996, conducting professional development programs for heads and teachers of schools across India and abroad, and has trained several thousand teachers over the past 20 years. She also writes extensively. She's written for The Times of India, The Economic Times, Education Word, Teacher Plus, Mentor, etc. And it's a pleasure to have you as our guest speaker. Today, she will be speaking on catalyzing change through a crisis, the opportunities and threats for schools in India. Over to you.
Thank you, Ramesh. And thank you, Praveen, for inviting me. And good afternoon, good evening, everybody. Just a minute. I'm just going to share my screen. Just a minute. Oops. Okay. Ramesh, just let me know if you can see it clearly.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Good evening, everybody. This is, thanks a lot to SVYM for inviting me. I want to talk to you today about, as the title says, catalyzing change through a crisis. And I've got a subtitle, threats and opportunities for schools in India. A lot of people have spoken about this particular quote, and many people have been ascribed to this quote: never let a serious crisis go to waste. It's an opportunity to do things you thought you could not do before. Many people have spoken about it. And so I think this particular quote is very, very relevant for all of us today in this past year, this 1.5 years of the pandemic. The pandemic has been truly a crisis. And I want us to deconstruct, my talk will be deconstructing the title. What do we mean by catalyzing change through a crisis? I'd like us to view 3 to 5 minutes of a few digital lessons, English, business studies, math, science, to showcase a problem that we have in our schools. And then we will discuss, well, what do we need to stop? What should we start? And going forth, what should we be looking ahead towards? So that's quickly an overview of my talk, my 20, 25 minute talk. Let's deconstruct the title, first of all, catalyzing change. When we talk about catalyzing change, it really means, how do we accelerate change? How do we actually speed up the whole process? And what are we changing? We're trying to change schools. We're trying to change the way we teach children. We're trying to change teaching learning processes. And teaching learning processes and schools are perhaps the most, are most slow to change in all aspects in other different parts of, you know, fields and functions and professions and so on. Other professions are far quicker and more responsive to change than schools are. Schools tend to stay far more status quo rather than than any other institutions in the world. And it's not just in India, it's pretty much in other parts of the world also. So we need to look at how do we accelerate process of change in our schools. Secondly, crisis. Crisis is, of course, what is still looming large, the COVID-19 crisis. We haven't gotten out of that crisis. We've had a horrible second wave. And how are we going to be leveraging this crisis? How are we going to make use of this crisis to catalyze change? That's what I want to talk about. And then what are the threats to teaching, learning in schools, and what could be opportunities? So that's sort of deconstructing the title for you. So to begin my talk, let's watch the short clip. It's just about 5 minutes. It's a set of asynchronous lessons sent by WhatsApp from a Bangalore school this past year. So it's not a government school. It is a low-cost private, it's a budget private school. And it's an English medium school. And they have obviously tried to look at, you know, teaching using online and digital modes. And this is how they have tried to do it. And these were lessons all from one particular school. And it's not pinpointing the problem in that school. It's pinpointing a larger issue, which cuts across all schools across the country. So let's watch the film first of all. Hopefully you'll be able to hear clearly also. In case you can't, Ramesh, just let me know. It's just sort of loading up.
Very good morning, children. Hope everyone are fine. Last class, we start.
Can you hear it clearly?
Yeah,
okay. Sorry, there's a bit of a lag, I think. Just a minute.
Six. The model millionaire, right, children? And we did the pre-reading task, that is, what makes a person rich and successful? It is luck or it is hard work? I hope that you got the hand. Started with the first part of the lover and the painter and a surprise, what happened? In the lover, obviously, Huggy Erskine, how he was. Okay, Huggy Erskine, how he was. What kind of personality he had, right? Let me read the questions. So, answer the following questions in 2 or 3 sentences. You have to answer in 2 or 3 sentences. What sort of a man was Huggy Erskine? So, that is from the first paragraph, okay? What sort of man was Huggy Erskine? He was a good man, right? All those things are not there for your upcoming summative exam, but obviously it will be there for your final exam. Got it, children? And this chapter was very nice. I liked it. I hope that even you liked it. Please read the chapter, understand, write the summary and do all your grammar book in your English book. Okay?
Happy morning. So we will start with the next a new lesson, chapter 13, reaching the age of adolescence. Now, one by one, we learn what are the changes that takes place. The first one is that you will increase in your height. Increase in your height. This is what actually happens. And normally, we can also say that is height is associated with gene, correct? If your father and mother.
Ramesh, Praveen, I hope there isn't an audio lag. I hope you're able to hear.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. The video too.
There's not too much of a lag.
Okay. I just want to also clarify to everybody who's listening in that I have just taken snippets of these classes. So obviously you're not getting the full picture, but you're getting a sense of how lessons have been planned.
Mother is... short, there is a chance that is you also will become short. Correct. Second one is shape of your body. Okay, body shape. Change in body shape. Okay. Second one is change in body shape. Shape of your body change. What is this shape? Change in body shape. See, for example, if it is a boy. It is a boy. The first one is broader shoulder, and the second one is that is wider chest. Your chest, wider chest. Okay, so these are the changes that normally happens. In which one you say? boys. But if it is of a girl, normally we will write girl, she will start looking beautiful. This is one. You please read your textbook and find out what and all are given in your textbook. Okay.
Hi children, do you remember what we have learnt in the previous class? Yes, we have learnt the area of trapezium and area of the rhombus, and we have solved a few sums based on these. In today's class, we are going to learn the surface area. First, let me see that what is the meaning of surface area. Surface area means surface area of a solid is the sum of the areas of all of its faces. Now look at here. So this is the better example. This is the best example of the cuboid. Okay, you can see all the faces are rectangular faces. So it is a cuboid. So the sum of the areas of all the faces. How many faces we have? We have 6 faces. Okay. So the sum of the areas of 6 faces is nothing but the surface area. Okay. Now we have the formulas for the sum of the solids. Now let me look at. These are the surface areas formulas we have here. First one, we have the surface area of a cuboid. The surface area of the cuboid is 2 into LH plus LB plus BH. So first one we have, find the side of a cube whose surface area is 600 centimeter square. Okay. Now what is the formula to find the surface area of a cube? Yes, it is nothing but the 6 into L square. So using this formula, we are going to find out the surface area.
So students of 8th standard, today we are going to learn a chapter from social science. The name of the chapter is Forms of Business Organizations. This chapter is taken from Business Studies. What is the name of the chapter? The name of the chapter is Forms of Business Organizations. My dear students, first we are going to study about the types of business organizations. First one is sole trading concerns. Second one is partnership firms.
Okay. So I'm going to stop there and I'll go back to my presentation. Just a minute. Yeah. So I hope all of you have seen it, and I hope this is an opportunity for us to reflect on what is actually wrong. What was wrong with this class or this set of these, set of classes? It was one class, of course. It was grade 8, and all these lessons were connected with grade 8. What was the problem? One is a deeply problematic pedagogy made painfully visible. That's what's happened in this past year. The pedagogy is the problem. It's not the technology. It is not, it's not the fact that it's the pandemic. The way we teach is the problem. How teachers are teaching, how teachers plan lessons, how teachers engage with children or understand how children's engagement has to be designed and so on. The other is an unimaginative use of textbooks, unnecessary and excessive teacher talk. Now, what all these four teachers have done is that they've translated exactly how they teach in regular physical classrooms. They've translated it into a virtual mode by recording classes where the teacher is explaining and talking and demonstrating. Including a green board and a stick. So that's the second problem. The third is that asynchronous lessons created with little understanding of available digital tools, and they're all for free. The digital tools which could be used, these were WhatsApp classes. These lessons were not synchronous classes like the way we are having. There were asynchronous classes where the teacher recorded these sessions and sent them by WhatsApp messages to the children. And the children were just expected to watch it and hopefully learn something. So those were the things that were wrong in the class. Now, the idea I want to highlight is that it's not about finding fault with the teachers concerned. It is about actually finding fault with the pedagogy which we continue and persist in following. Of course, there's been a lot of verdict. There's been a verdict on online teaching and learning, which I don't completely agree, partly because it's showing only part of the picture. For instance, there's been a very detailed report by titled Myths of Online Education by the Azim Premji University. It's been very well researched. And some of the verdict is that online learning opportunities are ineffective in providing any actual education. Yes, if it's done this way, absolutely it is ineffective. And the sad thing is that the way teachers have by and large been doing it has been that way, or slight variations, better or worse than what I've just shown you. So obviously it is ineffective, but it's not because online education is ineffective. It's the way we've understood online education that's ineffective. I completely agree, and therefore a big tick for this one, part of the APU's report again, teachers are ill-prepared for online learning platforms. Absolutely, I 100% agree. And I think teachers did a huge, made a huge effort at learning to use technology this past 1 year. Teacher, by and large, majority of our teachers, even in some of the best schools of our country, were not very comfortable with using technology, not even PowerPoint or interactive whiteboard. Forget about completely virtual classroom, virtual learning and virtual classrooms and virtual tools and so on. So teachers were ill-prepared and under-prepared, but they did a heroic job trying to do the best they can. There's been a lot of, digital learning and should schools open, should schools not open, etc. in the news recently. There's been a recent report which says digital learning achieved less than expected. And then another expert for Karnataka particularly, there was an expert panel which advised the government that we must reopen schools even though there is an expected third wave. The expert panel was, of course, not led by an educator or an educationist. It's been by a doctor, and obviously doctors would know that, is the third wave imminent or not. And then, of course, there's been another newspaper report which talked about no devices, millions of students stay offline, which is a fact. The vast majority of children in our school don't necessarily have access to devices. In fact, recently there was another report again in the newspapers which said less than 40% of children in Karnataka have access to devices. And across the country, perhaps only 20% of children have access to devices. So Karnataka, some of the southern states are in a better state. However, Kerala has 85 to 87% access to online education. Now that tells you something. Why is there such a vast difference from state to state? More recently, for Karnataka, the education minister has announced free smartphones for government school kids. We don't know if it'll happen, but at least the government is beginning to think about it. Another report was published, Karnataka to launch 2,500 smart classes and distribute tablet PCs to 1.5 lakh students. On Wednesday. Now, we don't know if that has happened either, but there have been announcements of smartphones or tablets being available for young people. Because obviously the government, 1 year down the line, is beginning to see that perhaps we have to equip our children with devices so that they can access learning and education from anywhere, anytime. We can't be constantly saying that, you know, government schools don't have access, children from the poorer sections of society cannot learn through online means. We are living in the 21st century. We're in the second decade of the 21st century. Into the third decade of the 21st century. We can't be constantly having excuses like this. We have to pull up our socks and make sure that we provide technological access to whoever needs it. The poorest of poor in the most rural part of India needs to have access to electricity and technology in pretty much in the same way as in all our metropolises. So what am I trying to say? I think we have to stop certain things, and it's high time we stop. Even in some of our good and best schools, we do still continue, but I think the private schools, especially the high-end private schools, have quickly learned to drop a lot of out-of-date and archaic practices. So what do we have to do to stop? What should we be stopping? Online learning can be problematic in a large country like India, no doubt, with poor rural access to devices and internet, but we have to stop certain bad practices. And I say bad in a very deliberate way, because they are archaic, they are out of date. They are 20th century practices, and that too not late 20th century, they're sort of early or mid 20th century practices, which we in schools have continued to hold on to as if, you know, that's the best way to learn, because we learned that way. I belong to that generation very, very clearly. I think we need to make sure that teachers stop using too much teacher talk in the classrooms. We keep observing teachers even now, whether it's online classes or in physical classrooms before the pandemic, and we find that teachers do too much talking. And children are expected to just listen and watch the teacher. That is an out of date, out of touch practice. Children do not learn the best that way. There's enough research from neurosciences. There's enough research from educational psychology. There's enough research from technology also to tell us that we have to stop talking and get children to be doing talking more. Teachers, we need to stop teachers, you know, asking just rote-based questions. So one thing we have to stop is teachers not asking higher order thought-provoking questions. Teachers often think that children will not be able to answer the higher order questions or questions that are a little bit more open-ended. So we tend to take resort in asking simple questions with simple one word, one sentence answers. And that's how we test them also. Unless we teach them to think with more open-ended questions, we will never be able to test them for higher order thinking. And the new education policy talks a lot about teaching for critical thinking, building children's, young people's critical thinking capabilities. How on earth are we going to be developing critical thinking abilities if we do not ask children higher order questions while we teach? And then, of course, while we test also. Another thing we have to stop is teachers not encouraging students to ask questions themselves. A lot of times it stems from our discomfort or hesitation or a feeling of inadequacy that, will I know the answers to any questions that the child asks? Or will they ask questions which are just completely out of the topic, completely tangential? Maybe, undoubtedly, some questions may be tangential, but that's okay. It's not the end of the world. But if we stop children, if we prevent children from asking any questions because we fear that time will be wasted with the tangential questions, then we're actually killing the spirit of inquiry and questioning completely. And very early on, we are killing that capacity. And therefore, they will never ask questions later on in life, whether they go into college or into workplace or into public service, etc. And last, another thing that teachers, we have to stop doing, and I'm not just saying teachers, but also I think schools in general, and governments have to support this, as well as the school, private school managements need to support this. Teachers not designing opportunities for students to learn collaboratively. Children are capable of learning amazing things by through talking to each other, discussing with each other. They're able to learn complicated games like chess. They're able to learn to use all kinds of apps on their smartphones. They're able to learn all kinds of things from each other. So why not leverage that capacity of human beings' ability to learn from each other? Why don't we leverage that while we teach curricular stuff in our schools? So these are things we have to stop. Too much talk, not asking higher order questions, not allowing children to ask questions themselves, and not allowing children to learn collaboratively from each other and with each other. What should we start? Because the idea of this talk is hopefully it has to be positive and upbeat and forward-looking. We need to start these few things. One is we need to remember that meaningful learning is not about technology. It's about developing critical thinking and social emotional skills. So this past year, even though many schools across the country have gone digital, have gone virtual, have been offering online teaching learning experiences for children, good, bad, or ugly, good learning is not, or effective learning is not technology. It's about developing these skills of critical thinking, social emotional skills, life skills, which are actually highlighted even in our new education policy. It is an alchemy. It's a wonderful combination of people, processes, and principles of good pedagogy. And that can create magic. And that's why I call it alchemy. It's an alchemy of people, the teachers and the students, processes in terms of what activities and experiences the teachers have designed for the children. And of course, it's based on underlying principles of good pedagogy, which have been detailed out for many, many decades. It is about learner engagement, discussion, dialogue, reflection, and of course, we must have a dash of fun. So, and that's something teachers have to meticulously design. It doesn't just happen just because a teacher is an amazingly inspired teacher. Inspiration comes from meticulous planning and design. And that's what we have to start doing. And lastly, we must remember that technology does, it's, while meaningful learning is not about technology, many, many hundreds and thousands of teachers or millions of teachers across the world have recognized this past year that technology offers us tools that we didn't have previously. And it makes it possible, makes meaningful learning possible in virtual mode. We need to start having clearly thought out weekly learning plans if we're going to continue this online mode another few weeks or months. Many schools may continue for months. Some schools are saying they're not planning to open till next academic year. We need to have blended topic plans using both synchronous and asynchronous sessions. And we need to focus on students' social, emotional learning and mental health and well-being. We can't ignore that while we focus on finishing curriculum. And I'd like to show you a sample overlay. We've actually provided learning plans, weekly learning plans and schedules for primary school, middle school, high school. I'm just showing you a sample of a middle school learning plan where there could be 7 to 8 periods in a given day across 5 days, Monday to Friday, as you can see. 20 minutes of time is set aside for the class teacher to connect with the children, you know, at a one-on-one or as a group with the class. No curriculum, just connecting, talking, getting to understand what's happening in each of their lives, etc. So that's the class connect. Then we have maybe English. These are just ideas. there could be 45 minutes of English, then 45 minutes of maths and so on. But you'd see that some of it is synchronous, some of it is asynchronous. Whatever's green is asynchronous. That means the child does it at his own time and pace, but it is designed in such a way that the child engages with it, not in the way that I showed you. The yellow ones are the synchronous style. That means the teacher will teach in real time, say using a platform like Google Meet or Zoom or Microsoft Teams or any other virtual meeting platforms. So you're alternating synchronous and asynchronous so that the child has a little bit of time, a little bit of, otherwise there's too much of, you know, screen fatigue for the child, especially screen fatigue where they have to listen in, you know, all together at the same time. And then there's not just academic subject, there could be library, there could be PE, there could be social emotional learning, there could be innovation time, as you can see there, and so on. We've also provided, a sample online schedule in a little bit more detail. So you can, I'll send you the links of that, as well as there's a sample topic plan of how a teacher can actually plan a lesson. Here's one example. I'm just going to show you. This is a grade 5 lesson plan. This is a topic plan. So that means for the whole topic. And there's some three periods. I'll just increase the thing so that you can see it a bit better. So the objectives are written clearly. What are the objectives? Students of grade 5 will be able to identify adjectives in a subject, categorize, et cetera, et cetera. Now, let me show you how that goes. We could have three sessions, as you can see. Two of them are asynchronous and one is in between is a synchronous. So asynchronous is not just the kind of lesson I showed you just right at the beginning of my talk. Asynchronous could be where the teacher has designed an activity which the child does or the children do at their own time. It could be, they could be watching a video and answering some questions using a Pear Deck activity with slides. So there are links, there are hyperlinks provided to the video as well as the assessment activity. Then there's the synchronous with clear instructions in terms of how do you introduce, how much time do you spend in everything, and then what are the resources you would use, whether it's a Google form, whether it's picture slides, whether it is a Google Jamboard, et cetera. And then a post-session task, which is again asynchronous, which is using another digital tool like Padlet. So all these are linked up. I don't want to spend time because I may be eating up time into the question and answer session. So this is how one would look at it. So I'm going to go off back to my presentation. Okay. Sorry, just a minute. So this is just to give you an idea, because there's no point finding fault and identifying the problems with those earlier classes, grade 8 classes that I showed you, unless we provide a solution. And solutions are available, very, very simple, accessible solutions. So I've provided you one set of solutions. So the important thing for us to remember is that when we look ahead, it is time for teachers to leapfrog into the 21st century. Many of us are continuing to teach as if it was mid 20th century, like in the 1950s and 60s. We can't be doing that. And I think the pandemic crisis has just highlighted and surfaced the problem. And it would be a sad day if, while there's been a lot of people, you know, wanting schools to be opening and campaigning for schools to open. And I think schools should open. But it would be sad if we do not use this opportunity to actually change the way we teach completely. And instead, we go back to doing things the way we were doing in 2018 and 19. That would be sad. Because then we haven't learned anything from this pandemic. And pandemics come only once in every 100 years. And if we have not, if we don't use this opportunity to change the pedagogy and teaching learning processes and experiences in our schools, we would be doing a huge disservice to the young people in our country. So with that, I want to say thank you. And you can follow us on Twitter or on Facebook, as well as we have a Teacher Foundation app called the TTF app on Google Play Store. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. You did highlight several aspects, which I think many of us did discuss it in several platforms with our peers. Sometimes we are maybe short of ideas. Sometimes we are short of time. Though the initial schedules of online classes started off with like once a day or once in 2 days, as it became more and more evident that we will be having online classes only for the rest of the year, yeah, it almost became a fully packed calendar. And the challenges with respect to the pedagogy or the higher order thinking skills not being brought into a classroom are not something new, if I may say. We have been discussing
that is true.
We have been discussing about these for quite some time. So I just wanted to kind of ask you, like, have you come across positive case studies where we have seen that a truly creative class was tried out? They do happen in islands of excellence here and there. What would be conducive environments for such classes? Is it more time for planning? Is it a really motivated teacher? What do you think makes up such a class?
I think it's a combination of all of what you've listed out. And you're absolutely right, Praveen, that this is not new. We all knew this. It's just that it's become far more visible, because otherwise it was happening behind closed doors in every classroom in across the country. But now it's just a link. You will go to the link and you can see classrooms. So it's become more visible. That's all. So it's not new, I agree. There's been enough research from across the world which talks about the fact that the single most important critical factor that improves the quality of teaching and learning is the teacher. There is no question about it. It's not technology. In the hands of a really thoughtful, reflective, inspired teacher, technology can do magic. But just technology is not going to create learning. Yes, children will learn how to use devices and access information, etc. But to become a thinking human being, you need another thinking human being. And that's what the teacher provides. There's been research from across the world, as I said. And in fact, it's not just, the single teacher. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with John Hattie's research. He's a professor of education in University of Melbourne, Australia, but he's a New Zealander, otherwise by birth. And he's done meta research, which means research on what are the factors that impact student learning. So he's done, and it's been across millions of students, several thousand studies. And he has found, and every year, every couple of years, he keeps renewing because there's new data emerging and so on. And he has found that collective teacher efficacy is the single most important factor that can have a positive impact on student learning. When we say collective teacher efficacy, it means that every teacher in the school is teaching well and teaching to the best of their capacity. Not that one star teacher in the school, and so everybody thinks that, yes, our school is good. Every single teacher making the effort to teach the best that they can in the school. And that's the least we can do for the young of our country.
There's one question in the chat box. It's very interesting. Question is, how reliable are assessments in the online environments? And how do we actually assess, or what are the methods that we can use to assess children's learning through the online mode?
Yeah, Great question. Thank you for asking that, especially in the backdrop of CBSE cancelling the grade 12 exams. We never thought that, you know, the big board exam, which is always this bogey for all schools and children, and especially in grade 12, that you can actually cancel it and life will continue. Life is not going to stop because the big board exam has been cancelled. So it tells you something that it's not about the exam, it's about how we teach, how children are learning. And can we have effective assessments? Of course, undoubtedly you can. And if you want to check if children are, you know, writing authentically, you can do real-time assessment. And there are many digital tools available where the teacher can be present. It's like all of you are here. I can pose a question and I can see how different children are responding. I can see it, we can do it. And also it is about, there are digital tools available for that. Apart from that, it's also about how are we framing the questions? Are we framing questions in such a way that we want them to give one word, one sentence answers and they can easily Google it and therefore give the right answer? Or are we going to frame questions in such a way that it requires them to think? Okay, so no doubt, let them Google and search, but they still have to understand in order to put together a coherent answer. And that's why what I was talking about, the higher order thinking questions and developing critical thinking abilities is so important. Let it be an open book exam. That's all right. And up to grade 5 or 6, you can actually assess children by their capacity to respond, capacity in terms of their homework assignments, the tasks that they do after every lesson or class and so on. You can test them and assess them that way. But in higher classes, you do need more formal assessments. And the formal assessments can be linked to higher order thinking. And there you can't just sort of, cut and paste everything. If you do that, it's very evident to a teacher. You just have to do a quick word search or search of big phrases, and you'll find that you'd be able to find out if the child has just lifted it from the internet. So it is possible. And actually in our country, we had a whole year to think it out. Now, I know organizations like the CBSE is beginning to think about how they're going to do exams for 2022. It's good that they're doing it, but I wish we had done it earlier. Last year, agreed, in March and April and May 2020, we really didn't know what was going to hit us. But by December, we knew this was going to be a problem and we could have functioned, acted fast. And assessments are possible. Online
sessions. Yeah, I've sat in on many of these online sessions just to get a feel for what happens during that. One of the things that I noticed, because I put myself in the shoes of a student as well as a teacher, because you were one at some point in time. I think two fundamental premises on which schooling has existed for a long time, which is obedience and compliance. I think both of these things were seriously challenged when things started to go, move into the online space. That's what I saw it as. I think both of these started to, and I saw visibly that, teachers feeling that they had actually lost control. I think that is, I saw as a fundamental issue that, although I've seen, the things moving, changing and all of that, I still see there are a great discomfort. It's people have improved in how they manage the technology, but they've still not been able to understand how that to let go in terms of, you talked about interactive learning, but that is not happening. How do you see that changing, if at all? Because if you're going back to classrooms again, we're going to be seeing this. What we have done is recreated a real classroom in a virtual space.
Exactly. I think that's a great question, Ramesh. I hope schools and teachers will not go back to how things were. Yes, they've learned to use technology. They've learned to use certain digital tools and certain apps and so on. But the point is that, as I said earlier, it's not about that. It is about learning. It is about understanding the principles of learning. And principles of learning highlight the fact that there has to be learner engagement, that you have to be developing their cognitive and thinking capabilities. And you have to, and in order to do that, you have to design activities and experiences. All of it requires a teacher to think things out. Even if one has taught for 25 years, you have to still go into a class or go virtual class or a physical class with a clear idea of what am I going, how am I going to create a learning experience for children? It's not about what am I going to teach. It's about what do I want children to learn from this 40 minutes or 45 minutes that I'm going to be spending with them. I think that shift has to happen. And I think it has happened for a small but significant minority of our schools across the country because of the pandemic. I think certain things became immediately visible. And that comes from either the teacher herself having gone through a learning process, self-learning and reflection, or because the school management has decided that we need to equip our teachers. We need to think about how's learning happening? How do we make learning possible and so on? So I would say it depends on the school leadership. If it's a private school, school leadership, even if it's a government school, but with a government school, it'll be the government department of education. And it could also be dependent on the individual teacher. But the thrust and has to come from the people on the top. And that is the leadership.
Just have a follow-up on what you just now mentioned regard to leadership. What we've also seen is that many teachers have been allowed to flounder in terms of not being without being provided the support or the infrastructure from not just from particularly in the budget schools that you spoke about or in big private schools as well.
I agree.
So, what has been the experience? Have you had any discussion with founders or trustees of such schools, and what are the issues that they have come up with in terms of not being able to manage this critical issue of the teachers being able to of supporting teachers itself?
Yeah, I think it's the fact. I think it stems from a lack of imagination and understanding of teaching and teachers if they've not been able to support. Wherever we have worked with groups of schools as well as many schools where the school leadership and school management has quickly recognized that this is not okay, this is not happening, we need to support teachers. We need, because you can't just, They were just sort of thrown in deep end. Teachers were thrown in deep end last April, May. And it was a case of sink or swim. So they desperately tried to stay afloat. And they was trying to stay afloat like those classes that I just showed you a while ago. That was a case of staying afloat. And the school managements had to quickly recognize that this is not okay. We need to support them. It was highlighting an illness that was pervasive in our school system. And fortunately for some schools and some teachers, the school management quickly recognized it and supported. In some cases, the support was adequate, more than adequate. In some cases, it was not adequate because they just thought it just means that they have to know how to use Google Classroom or how to use Zoom. What are all the different icons and how do you switch it on and how do you start a class and so on. It's not about the technicalities of it. It is about recognizing that learning is happening when I'm not able to sense the children in my classroom. I'm not able to see them. I'm not able to hear them. And a lot of times children could also manipulate the teacher because they can just say, ma'am, I've got internet issues, and they can switch off their audios, switch off their videos. And the teacher just doesn't know. And if the teacher just bashes on talking, she can feel that, yes, I taught. What to do if the children are not listening? But it is the teacher's responsibility to make sure children are learning. And it is the responsibility of the school leadership to support the teachers so that they can do the best they can. So it's complex. And in some cases, and some small minorities of governments, there has been some support provided, but the vast, vast majority of our schools have just floundered. And there's been no strategy in terms of how are we going to help us support our teachers in order that they help children learn as well as they can. So it is, so that's been the sort of dark side, but the silver lining has been that I think now teachers will adopt technology a lot more easily. We've worked with government school teachers coming from rural parts of Karnataka as well as Maharashtra. And we worked with urban teachers in the metropolises of Delhi, Bangalore, Bombay, Hyderabad, Chennai, and so on. So, and we've seen that all of them have found this exciting and empowering. And I think we need to go, but they need a lot of support.
During the brief period in Jan and Feb when the classes were open, when the schools were open, a lot of teachers had this very common complaint that they have two challenges with the kids. One is they seem to have forgotten the ability to write. And the second one is to be able to sit in one place for 40 minutes. Did you come across how this the schools where you worked, were there any creative ways of getting kids back to school and being attentive enough to learn?
So a lot of the schools, at least the private schools that we were working with, many of them didn't open at all. Many of them, because parents were not willing to send their children to school. I think many parents were cautious. In some schools, they did reopen, and teaching was happening in the usual way. But the vast majority, and we don't just work with schools for the privileged. We do work with low-cost private schools and government schools. Government schools, of course, the teaching was happening in Karnataka through Vidyagama, and to some extent, I don't think there was any real concerted plan. There was a little bit of this and a little bit of that, a little bit of television, a little bit of Vidyagama classes. There wasn't a clear focus. But with private, even low-cost private schools in Bombay and Bangalore and other parts and all that, many of them didn't open, partly because they're also very congested schools. So they didn't think it was safe. So in those cases, they continued to do some semblance of online teaching and learning. Wherever they did open, yes, some teachers did complain. But I think it came up from the fact that it's very easy to revert to type. And if teachers revert to the usual way of teaching, it just gets boring very quickly, because earlier at least there was a little bit of glitz from using technology for the child. And if they're just going to be sitting in rows and listening to a teacher, it might get a little mechanical and boring. And that's something we have to be careful. And mind you, when I talk about mechanical and boring, it's not about just creating, a lot of glamour or glitz in the classroom. It is about making it relevant and engaging for children. If you get children to think, they will keep it and excited about learning, they will stay focused.
There's a nice comment in the chat box. Without the way of evaluation changing, there are many challenges. If the evaluation metric changes to evaluate how students think, then teachers might also evolve in the way they teach. So all of it sort of revolves around how assessments are done. So unless we sort of handle that issue, maybe we might not be able to sort out this issue.
I think that's in the hands of the teachers. I would say more power to teachers, and teachers, you have the power, just grab it and use it. Use it for the greater good of children. You can change the assessment. It's only in the 10th and 12th that you have to be looking at the board. Everywhere else, in all the other classes, it is up to you, and it's up to your school community, I don't think anybody's going to be breathing down your neck and asking, why are you assessing this way when you were always assessing in another way, and so on. You can change the assessment approaches.
Radhika has a question.
Hi, Maya. Radhika here.
Radhika.
Yeah, we met 2 decades ago in Mumbai and everywhere. Yes, so yes. Nice to see you. Yeah. So Maya, see, we are contemporaries, you know, whatever you have shared today, nothing is new. So we've been talking about this, only the situation has changed, the pandemic has come, but we're talking about the same thing as you have said and Praveen has said. So we are talking about the same thing, which is the pedagogy and the teacher empowerment and the teacher creativity and all of that. So I have 2 questions. One is in the existing, see, even though somebody talked about founders and trustees and, you know, management. So I don't see there are, you also know this, there are management who are ready to do a lot of things. I mean, plunge into a lot of things, but the system does not permit. There is a tightness and toxicity in the system itself, which does not permit a lot of things to happen. Like somebody talked of assessment and, all of that. So this question, the focus question is, when you have a timetable of 45 minutes, 40 minutes or whatever, it's very difficult for, it becomes a piecemeal teaching. It's very difficult for any educator, any teacher to do something very creative within that 45 minutes. Secondly, the point that you also brought out about the contact that you make with the children through circle time or whatever, in the initial, the start of the day, giving importance to socio-emotional development. How can these 2 things happen without an easy flow of time for the teacher? So are there any schools or any institutions where they have kind of broken this whole barrier of timetable and worked around it?
Yeah, great, important question, great question. Thanks, Radhika. I think there are lots of schools who have broken that barrier. They have experimented with new ways of scheduling the timetable. They have recognized, there are lots of schools who increasingly recognize the need to give teachers time and space for planning collaboratively with other teachers. So all the teachers teaching, say if it's a large school and there are many sections, all the teachers teaching maths for grade 5 or language for grade 8, sitting together and planning, and also providing opportunities for teachers to pursue their own professional development or planned professional development from the school side. And it's only a thinking school that will do that. A thinking school will quickly realize that there are certain inadequacies in all our teachers, and we need to make sure that all our teachers come up to a certain required standard. And there may be certain individual inadequacies that every teacher has. We all have that. And maybe that can be pursued at an individual level. So that's where school leadership is important. I always talk to, whenever we have a program called Headlamp, which is the Heads Leadership and Management Program. And we keep talking to, when we discuss it as part of our, it's now a completely online session. And we say that heads are not just administrators, they are leaders of learning. So the single fundamental thing heads have to do is ensure that learning is happening effectively. And how learning happens in the pre-primary or primary years is different from the middle school years and the high school years. There must be rigor, there must be fun, there must be meaning for children, relevance for children. And that there has to be a leader who drives that whole process. Otherwise, individual teachers may do it or may not do it. But collectively, if you want the school to be of a certain standard, we need the leader to drive it. The school leadership to drive it.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Maya.
You're welcome.
I think we are almost at the end of this. We could go to closing remarks. I just had one question, so I'll roll it into the closing remarks. Is that, one of the things that teachers perhaps need to examine is if they can help students become their own teachers. Is that something that we should be looking at, given how difficult we are, how difficult this pandemic has been?
Yes, in fact, that's what I said, that we have to start, helping children, start helping teachers recognize that you can design learning experiences four different lessons, whether it's maths or science or English or social studies or any other subject, through developing collaborative activities. Children can learn a lot from each other, but you require, the teacher has to design the activity. It's like designing a game. Instead of a game, you're designing a learning experience for children. If they have to learn, say, solar system, or if they have to learn, laws of thermodynamics, or, you know, depending on, and anything in between, the teacher has to design, how am I going to get children to learn this? What are the things I could do? What activity could I get them to do? And can they do it individually, or can they do it in groups or in pairs? Can I use technology for it? How do I use it? So these sort of questions have to fire the teacher. That's why the teacher is so important. And the teacher was important in the 1970s and 80s. The teacher is even more important in 2021, even though we have so much of information and technology available to us now compared to then.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think this was it's left us with quite a lot of questions to ponder over. I think that's good. I think most of us will need to think about what we need to do to, the challenges are plenty, but I think, and there aren't many answers, but questions, of course, that need to be answered. And thank you very much. It's been a most enlightening session. I think we enjoyed. Thank you very much. I want to take this opportunity to thank you on behalf of SVY and
Robbins. Thanks, and, Ramesh. Thanks, Praveen. And thank you all for sitting in on a late Saturday evening, all of you. And stay well, stay safe, all of you. Bye.
And thank you also to all our participants. I must say that we did mention that this is the penultimate session of this season. We'll have, next week we'll have the 50th episode. We'll do one episode on the 51st, because it so happens that the 51st episode, the 51st Saturday, would be Guru Purnima. So we thought we should connect the first episode with the, well, what would be the last episode. So we look forward to all of you joining us on that day as well. We should be live next week. We enjoyed it. I hope you enjoyed it as much as we did in bringing it to you. Thank you and have a great week. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Bam.
Bye. Bye.